tangled up in my headphone again. Good morning and welcome to Magnolia Methodist, where we are rooted in God's grace. Thank you for everyone joining us here in person and on our live stream. Thank you. For those on the live stream, you may notice a little bit different. We have a second camera installed up and running, so it's going to give you a little bit of a different look so you can see more of the sanctuary. Again, thank you for joining us for worship on this beautiful Sunday morning. Couple quick announcements before we begin. This afternoon at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, if you check your email, you should have a Zoom link to a church-wide town hall informational meeting. In 2 weeks, we have our charge conference where we approve budget and leadership and nominations and kind of set the tone for 2021. Tonight at 4 o'clock, we're going to be talking about one of the things we'll be voting upon, and that's a single board governance, a new way to organize ourselves as a church for mission. Several of our leaders have spent several months reading, researching, studying, and putting together a proposal. And we'd like to give a little bit more information, answer any last-minute questions so that we are prepared to vote upon it in 2 weeks' time. So that's tonight at 4 o'clock. Charge conference is in 2 weeks. That's September 27th, and that'll be at 2 in the afternoon. And so we pray that everyone will join us. This is the time to hear about what we have done as a church this year and what we hope to do next year as we put 2020 in the rearview mirror, gratefully. So please join us in 2 weeks' time. We have a lot going on in the life of the church. Sunday schools have restarted. We're beginning to slowly regather for worship. Keep our church in prayer. With that, let us begin worship with an opening prayer. Will you pray with me? Father Almighty, thank you. Thank you for this time that we've been given and the opportunity to gather together and to worship you. God, we pray that you'll fill this place with your Holy Spirit and fill the hearts and the homes of everyone joining us on the live stream with your Holy Spirit. Remind us that even though in this time we may be socially distanced, we are still one church. We are still one community. God, bind us together and lift us up this morning as we begin a new worship series. Help us to think about how we can communicate your good news, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, to our world. Be with us in this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have Marcy and Michelle joining Caleb this morning to lead us in worship. We pray, if you're here in person, if you'll sing quietly behind your mask, if you're at home, belt it out as loud as you want. Nobody else, nobody can hear you. Do what you need to do. Let's worship together this morning and be reminded that we are God's and God is with us. Amen.
Southward north, I'll go.
Amen. At this time, we have an opportunity to go before God with our praise and with our prayers. I know the needs are many. I've been receiving text messages this morning, been watching the news. Let's begin with praying for the people in the western United States facing the wildfires. We have family members with family members out that way. Let's continue to pray for them and all the people affected. The news has not been good. Drew Vaughn, our youth leader, his wife, her sister is having open heart surgery tomorrow. She's asked for prayers for her. She's 45 years old and facing heart surgery. Let's remember Al Hissett and he and his father. His father is perhaps in his last days. And so let's pray for Al and his family. Let's pray for everybody affected by this pandemic, whether they have been infected by it, whether they know somebody that has been infected, whether they've lost someone, or whether they've lost a job or felt their business suffer. The effects of this thing are wide-ranging and multiple. Let's pray for everybody in this time. And let's continue to pray for our church that we here in Magnolia, as Magnolia United Methodist, have an opportunity to share God's love and God's grace with our world, with our community in this time. Let us pray that we may be faithful in all that we do. With that, let us pray together this morning. Father Almighty, thank you. Thank you that we can come before you with our prayers and with our praise. God, you know our needs better than we do and before we do. So we trust in your will and we pray that you will hear our prayers this morning. As we pray for those who are facing sickness or surgery. As we pray for people who have been displaced or lost homes or who have perished in the wildfires in the west of our country. We pray for the people of Louisiana as they continue to recover from Hurricane Laura. And God, we pray for our world as this pandemic continues. We pray that we may discover a vaccine and an effective treatment to bring this thing under control. And so that we may be able to come together as we used to. But God, in the middle of this, you still call us to be faithful and to be your church. God, help us to minister to our community and to minister to our world however we can. Open our eyes and spark our imaginations that we may see what you are calling us to do. And in the middle of all this, there is still much to be thankful for life and for health, for daily provision, for the gift of family and friends, for new life, for all those things that bring us joy. God, we give you praise and we ask that you hear our prayers as we now pray the prayer that your Son, Jesus Christ, taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Let us continue worshiping as we are now led and shine, Jesus, shine. Let us worship God together.
Shining, Jesus, Lord.
Amen. At this time, for our families joining us on the live stream, it's time for Mr. Brent and the children's lesson. I always look forward to seeing what Brent has up his sleeve.
Well, good morning, boys and girls. Today, we're going to talk about remembering, what you remember and maybe why we do remember it. So what I want you to do is think of what you did yesterday. Think of something that you did yesterday. Maybe you played with your friends. Maybe you worked around the house. Maybe you rode your bike. Maybe you remember a good meal that your mom and dad then made for you. But I'm sure there's something that you can remember that you did yesterday. Not too hard to do. Now what I want you to do is remember when you first started to walk. Or maybe when you spoke your first words. That's a little more difficult, isn't it? But possibly your parents took a picture of you when you first walked. Or maybe a video of when you were talking. So that was a good way that you can remember what you did back then. Well, the church does the same thing. There are certain things we do in this sanctuary that help us remember about God. Now, one of the things is right here is a candle that's lit. And you got to wonder, why do they light candles in a church? I mean, there's light bulbs that can light up the church. You got light bulbs, so why do we need a candle? Well, a long time ago, there were no light bulbs. There were just candles to light up dark rooms, or when you're in the dark, you had to light a candle to find your way. Well, in the same way, the early church would go ahead and light special candles to remind them that Jesus, to follow in Jesus' steps through the light that he shines, the love that Jesus shines, is a way for us to remember by lighting candles. So that's why we light candles. But you know, I'm sure, boys and girls, there's other things that in this church that you wonder, why do we do that? So like, why do we even sing songs and music in church? Or why do we put our hands together when we pray? So boys and girls, what I want you to do is if you see something that we're doing in church and wonder, why do we do that? Ask your mom or dad or ask other people in the church to help them explain, because the things that we do here help us remind us about God and God's Son, Jesus. All right, boys and girls, let's put our hands together. Dear God, I thank you for the things that remind us in this church about you, God, and about Jesus' love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Have a good day, boys and girls.
Amen. Thank you, Brent. This time, as Caleb comes back to play an instrumental piece for us to center our hearts and minds as we prepare to hear God's word read and then preached. If you have your Bibles, I invite you to turn to Acts chapter 8. We're going to read five short verses from the 8th chapter. This is the time of the worship service where we would normally receive the morning's offering. If you're here with us this morning, you can leave an offering in the basket on the way out, or you can go to magnoliaumc.org, click the donate button, and leave an offering there. Thank you for your generosity. It has enabled us to continue to minister and to reach out into our world and our community in ways that we haven't been able to do before. Thank you. With that, as Caleb plays, prepare yourselves to hear this morning's scripture read and then preached. Amen. Thank you, Caleb. Thank you, Michelle, and thank you, Marcy. If you have your Bibles, Acts chapter 8, and I made a typo on the slide. Instead of hitting 6, I hit 5. We're actually going to pick it up in verse 26. Acts chapter 8, verses 26 through 31. Hear these words. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza." So he started out, and on his way, he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of the treasury of the Kandake, which means queen of the Ethiopians. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home was sitting in his chariot, reading the book of Isaiah the prophet. The Spirit told Philip, "Go to that chariot and stay near it." Then Philip ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah the prophet. "Do you understand what you are reading?" Philip asked. "How can I?" he said, "unless someone explains it to me." So he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. The word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. I've shared before how my last job before moving to North Carolina and being appointed to serve two churches without ever having taken a class in seminary before I started at Duke, my last job was working at LensCrafters. I was over the retail floor. I was responsible for the customers when they came in and to look at their prescription, determine what we could do, and to help them find the frames that they liked and would work for their prescription. I got to help people see better than they did when they entered my store. But as a manager, even though I was over the retail side, I needed to at least have a pretty good working knowledge of the lab side where we actually made the glasses. I could talk all the technical lingo. I knew what prism and cylinder and sphere and PD and axis and optical center all meant and how they worked together to help people see better. I could verify measurements and check to see if the final product was within the narrowly allowed variances before we gave them to the customer. I could repair their glasses if it was fixable. I could help customers find frames and help them determine which lens were best suited to their needs. I could block up the lens blanks in the back and could determine which base curves they needed or were possible to be used to make their prescription. I learned how the eye actually works. But you know what? My customers didn't care one bit about that. They didn't care that I knew all the technical details or could help out in the lab in a pinch. They were unconcerned with the minutiae of how their glasses were made. And if I forgot that I was talking to a customer and slipped into the technical lab lingo, you could almost see the confusion set in and look at me like, "I don't know what you're saying." While I was speaking English, they didn't actually understand what I was saying. They didn't care about whether they had presbyopia or myopia or hyperopia. All they wanted was to see more clearly and hopefully feel a little bit confident in their new glasses. But how often do we as Christians make the same mistake? How often do we use insider language, what I've heard called Christianese, when talking about our faith or when worshiping together? It's technically English, but is it understood by the people that we are called to reach, the people we're called to go to? Are we making our calling to go and to make disciples of Jesus Christ harder because we aren't speaking their language, and they don't understand ours? If they come and join us for worship, do we make them feel unwelcome when they technically understand the words that are being said, but the meaning of what's going on is lost upon them? Our task for the next several weeks will be to look at our Christianese language, our Christianese words, these churchy words that we use here, and what they really mean, hopefully, in everyday language, so we can better tell our world that we are sent to the story of God's grace. But before we begin by looking at some of these words in the next several weeks, we need to start with a question of why. Why should we learn to speak their language? If they're in search of God, if God's pulling on their heart, then why do we need to learn to speak their language? Shouldn't it be upon them or upon God to help them understand us? Why is it our responsibility to learn a new language? We start with the book of Acts, and Acts is an extremely important book for the Christian church because in it we catch a glimpse of the earliest Christians beginning to spread the message of Jesus Christ outside of Jerusalem. We enter the story this morning of the book of Acts with Philip. Now, Philip has been extremely busy. We actually meet Philip two chapters earlier in Acts as he is chosen alongside Stephen and a couple of other people to see to the needs of the growing community of Christians inside of Jerusalem. But after Stephen is stoned to death by those who were trying to stamp out this early church, after he was stoned to death where Saul, who winds up writing most of the New Testament, as he was standing alongside, after Stephen is stoned, the church is scattered. The church branches out from Jerusalem. And Philip ends up in Samaria. You know, Samaria, that place that good Jewish people would often go all the way around either side to avoid going through Samaria, because good Jews don't associate with Samaritans. But Philip ends up there. And while he's there, he begins to tell the people the story of Jesus Christ. Now, at least one village, the village where the Samaritan woman by the well lived, they already knew about Jesus. But he begins to tell them about Jesus and his death and his resurrection, and many people are healed and baptized, and this growing movement of Jesus Christ spreads inside of Samaria. Now, this grabs the attention of Peter and John back in Jerusalem, and so they show up and get involved. They take over the work that Philip has begun, but the Holy Spirit had something else for Philip to do. So the Holy Spirit tells Philip to go down to the desert road that connects Jerusalem to Gaza. Now, this was an important road. This was the road that connected Jerusalem to Gaza, and the trade routes that connected Jerusalem, or Africa, Rome, and Persia passed through the Holy Land, through Gaza. And this road from Jerusalem to Gaza would have been an important road. So the Holy Spirit tells him to go down to the road. He doesn't tell him anything else. Just tells Philip, go down to the road. And so Philip goes down to the road. He doesn't ask why, he just does. And as he is on his way, he's passed by an Ethiopian eunuch riding in a chariot. Turns out this Ethiopian was a man of some importance and influence. He was over the queen's treasury. Now, after having worshipped in Jerusalem, he is now headed back home. And as he's being driven along in his chariot, because he doesn't walk, he's an important man, as he's being driven along the road back down to Gaza, he's reading aloud the book of Isaiah. And the Holy Spirit nudges Philip and tells him to go and keep up with the Ethiopian's chariot. Philip is on foot. He's in a chariot. And God wants him to keep up with the chariot. If I'd have been in the scene, if this had been me, there would have been a scene where y'all would have read that I looked up to the sky and go, really? But apparently Philip was in better shape and much more submissive than I am, and so he does exactly that. He runs up and he's able to keep alongside this chariot. And as he's doing that, he hears the Ethiopian reading aloud from the book of Isaiah. And he asks this man, this complete stranger, this powerful and influential man sitting in a chariot, he asks him, "Do you understand what you are reading?" And here's the key. This is the moment that changes the story. Instead of just assuming something about this person and starting to preach at this stranger, he opens with a question. It's a question that has an invitation embedded inside of it. Do you understand what you are reading? And the Ethiopian replies, "How can I, unless someone explains it to me?" Philip is being given an opportunity to have a conversation with this man about Scripture. And Philip, this man, this random stranger walking alongside the road, is invited by the Ethiopian, this powerful and influential figure, to come and to sit with him in his chariot and have a conversation. And he points this Ethiopian to Jesus Christ. And it ends with this Ethiopian man pointing to some water and goes, "There is some water. What is stopping me from being baptized?" And after he is baptized, we read that Philip is taken somewhere else, taken out of sight, and the Ethiopian eunuch climbs back into his chariot and continues on his way home rejoicing. He is now carrying with him the message of Jesus Christ into new territory. This chance encounter from the Ethiopian's perspective takes the message of Jesus Christ, just barely beginning to spread outward from Jerusalem, now takes it into Africa with him. Chance encounter from the Ethiopian's perspective, but divinely arranged from God's. And it wouldn't have happened unless Philip had listened to the Holy Spirit, and if Philip wasn't able to speak the same language as the Ethiopian. For us who have been given a message to share, we are commanded to go and to make disciples of Jesus Christ. And we have the same task before us, to listen to the Holy Spirit and to learn to speak the language of the people around us. But we live in Magnolia. Everyone already speaks English, right? Yes, we speak English, but I've learned that even though we speak the same language, meanings are often different. Last year, when I had just begun here, it was a couple months in, I was sitting down with Miss Marilyn Hitchcock, who decorates our altar and is responsible for taking care of our sanctuary. We sat down to talk about what we were going to do in this space for Advent. And she was sharing with me what y'all would normally do. The Christmas trees, the Christmas tree, the decorations on the altar, the poinsettias, and then she mentioned, and we run garland down the length of the sanctuary. And I made a face. She goes, "You don't like that idea." And I'm like, "Not really." And so we backed off on the idea of running garland down the side. A couple of days later, somebody had to interpret our different languages. Marilyn was meaning the green garland. It's nice and classic down the side. I grew up and garland was tinsel garland. That's all I knew. Tinsel down the side, no way. We were speaking the same word. We were using the exact same words, but we had different meanings. Marilyn and I still joke about that. She still gives me grief about garland. We were speaking the same language, but meaning two entirely different things. Jesus was a master at being able to speak the language of those that he was reaching out to. When Jesus called his first disciples, those that he was reaching out to, he didn't tell them to follow him and to become his disciples. These were simple fishermen. He said to them, "Follow me and I will make you fishers of men." They may not have understood what being a disciple was, but they knew fishing. And Jesus was speaking their language. He was talking fishing with them. When he preached his Sermon on the Mount, he used illustrations that people could literally see. The lilies of the field, the salt of the earth, he could point down to a fishing village, Magdala, on the sea of the shore of Galilee, where they would bring the fish in and salt them to preserve them. You are the salt of the earth. He could point across the Sea of Galilee to one of the Decapolis cities. You are a city set on a hill that cannot be hidden. He used images that they could see, that they understood and connected with. In his parables, he used images like wheat and weeds and lost coins and shepherds and sheep. Images that the people could readily and easily grasp and understand. But today, in a time where people increasingly see less and less use for the church and for faith and for God, when the only images that they see on TV of Christians are Christians acting badly, abusing and discriminating and judging people and yelling at people on the street corners in the name of God, and then we come along and try to invite them to church and to tell them about this thing that has changed us and means so much to us, they look at us like we've lost our minds. We try to use words like sin and grace and communion and salvation. They have no idea what we're talking about. But I've also found that people who have attended church all their lives, if we asked some of us, what does sacrament mean? Or sanctification or fellowship or justification mean? While we may have grown up hearing those words, we may not be able to actually define them. We might have some foggy idea of what they really mean, and so we nod our heads and go along, even though we too might have questions of our own. Last week I said that God is not glorified by ignorance. A blind sheep is not what we are called to be. We're called to know what we believe and why we believe. So when we are given an opportunity, like Philip, when someone asks us why we believe, we can answer them. We can answer them in a way that they can understand, without having to use the SAT words. Making disciples of Jesus Christ isn't just my job. It isn't just the responsibility of the pastor. My job is to help equip each and every one of us, because we are all ministers, and you are able to reach people that I can't. My job is to equip all of us to be able to confidently share our faith with those around us whenever we are given an opportunity. And they will ask. If you listen to our world, we will hear a desire for something more than what they can find. Something real, something meaningful. They're looking for and wanting the very thing that we have found: Jesus Christ. I'm a sucker for a good story. I love music and movies and books. And one of my favorite things is whenever I'm reading a book or watching a movie or listening to a song, and I find those random moments, those random scenes in a movie or a passage in a book or a verse in a song that, whether they know it or not, talks about this desire for something more. And I wonder how we can use that as an opportunity to share our faith with our world. There can be opportunities to talk about faith and God and all the things that our faith at its best has to share with our world. They will be there. It doesn't matter how smart any of us are, though. It doesn't matter how much we know. It doesn't matter how perfect our faith is if we aren't able to share it with people in ways that they understand. In seminary, I was told that if you can't talk about some of these difficult theological concepts in ways that children can understand it, then you don't know what you're talking about. God, from the very beginning, has demonstrated God's love and God's will for us in ways that we can experience and point to. And we are called to do the very same thing. Missionaries used to go to peoples who had never heard the good news of Jesus Christ. And they would build schools and try to teach them their language, whether it was English or French or Italian or Portuguese or whatever it was. And while teaching them their language, they would try to sneak in the message of God. But today, missionaries know it's upon them to learn to speak the language of the people that they are going to, so that they can be better understood. We don't have to go halfway around the world. We just have to walk out our front doors, able to share the love of God and the good news of Jesus Christ in their language, in ways that they are able to understand. If we are to be about the work of the kingdom of God, if we are to live into the great commission that Christ gives to each and every one of us, we must make sure that we are being heard, but more than being heard, that we are understood. Otherwise, we're just wasting our time. God spoke our language. Let's do the same. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. As Caleb comes back and as the musicians lead us in a reprise of Shine, Jesus, Shine, I want you to think about, what are those words that perhaps you're curious about? What do they really mean? I've prepared a tentative list of the words that we're going to spend the next couple of weeks of redefining: sin and grace and sacrament and fellowship and sanctification and justification. But if there are other words that you have, what do they really mean? Let me know. I want to know so maybe we can work those in. But as they sing, think about how we are called to go out into the world and how we can better communicate God's love and God's grace to a world in search of something real. Amen. Thank you for joining us for worship this morning, whether you're here or in person. And please, if you're able, I invite you to leave an offering either in the basket or on our website. We appreciate you being here. Don't forget 4 o'clock this afternoon, our church-wide Zoom meeting to talk about a proposed change in our organization as a church. And in 2 weeks, our charge conference at 2 in the afternoon. We'll be sending that link out in the coming week, in 2 weeks' time, so everybody has it in their inbox. Thank you for joining us for worship. Go forth in grace. Go forth to a world looking for something real. Speak their language so that they may hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Go in the peace of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. See you next week.